This is the second part of the character selection menu. Here in the corner, I leave you the link to the previous video where I show how this prototype works. In this video, we're going to talk about the two control scripts, so it's necessary to know how the system works. This first script controls the system in the menu scene, and this other script controls the system in the game scene. So let's start with the first one. Here among the public fields, we see the definition of the player objects array, this one here in the inspector, where all the available characters will be placed. Then we have this index that is gonna allow us to access the characters in the array. If the index is 1, we're gonna access the element 1 of the array. Then this is just the name of the scene that we're gonna load by pressing the green button, and this string is the name that will have the data that we're going to save in memory. Now let's analyze all the functions, starting with hide all characters. This function disables all the characters in this way. Notice that we have a for each loop that is going to go through each of the elements inside player objects and execute the setActive function with false as parameter. In the corner you have a video about how to activate and deactivate game objects in Unity. In the start function, which is executed before the first frame of the game is shown, the first thing we do is to execute this function. So at the beginning, all the characters are going to be hidden. The next step is to initialize the index. Here, using this instruction, we read the index that is stored in memory under this name. And in case it's the first time the game is executed and there is no value in memory, we initialize it with 0. So the first time the game is started, the character we're gonna see on screen is gonna be the first on the array. Then we have the functions to change the character, next character and previous character. These functions are executed by the buttons. If you look here, for example, in the onClick event of the next button, we have this next character function selected. So these functions, as we saw in the explanation of the previous video, do 3 things. The first is to turn off the character that is currently selected. We access the array with the current index and execute the setActive function with false as parameter. This is done in both functions. Then we modify the index. In the next character function we increase it, and in the previous character we decrease it. Next, we check if we are pointing to a valid element of the array. Here, for example, the index is 2. It's pointing to the last valid element of the array. If we increase the index now, it's gonna be 3. And if we try to access the array with that value, it will give us an error. So we have to ask if the value of the index is 3, and if that's true, make the index 0. That way we go to the next element in the list. To generalize, we check if the index is greater or equal to the size of the array. Then in this way, it doesn't matter how many elements we have. Here, as we see, if the condition is true, we make the index equal to 0. In the previous character function, on the other hand, we check if the index is negative. Look, right now the index is 0. If we decrease it by 1, it will be minus 1, and that doesn't point to a valid element. In that case, we have to make the index equal to the size of the array minus 1. For example, in this case, the size of the array is 3, minus 1 is 2. In doing that, we will be accessing a valid element of the array. Finally, we activate the new character. We access the array with the new index and execute the setActive function with true. We do this in both functions. Then doing all this, we can navigate between all the characters of the array. The last function is startGame. It does 2 things. The first is to save in memory the value of the index using this name, and then we load the next scene. Now let's see how the game control script from the game scene works. Here we have the parameters. The first is the array with the characters, but in this case the references are prefabs from the assets folder. As we saw in the previous video, this array has to be exactly the same as the one in the menu, otherwise we may spawn the wrong character. Then we have a transformation that tells us where to place the character. Here in the inspector we have this object assigned. In the position of this object is where the character will appear. Next we have the name of the menu scene to load it when pressing this button here. Then again we have the name of the index stored in memory. This is not a good practice because we are defining the same data in 2 different places and we could get confused and put different names in each one. But for now let's leave it this way. Not the best solution, but it's simple. Here we have a reference for the index we are gonna read from memory. And finally, this public reference of the character's game object. In the start function, we initialize the index, reading it from memory, and if there is no data in memory, initialize it with 0. Next, we place the character on the stage with this instruction, the instantiate function. We use it with 3 parameters: the game object of the character we want to create, the position in which it has to be placed, and the rotation. In this case, we use the rotation that the prefab itself has defined. And notice that all this instruction is assigned to this object. With that, we save the reference of the instantiated character in this variable, and we can access it later if we need it. In the corner, I leave you a video about how to randomly instantiate game objects. The last function returns us to the main menu by simply loading the previous scene using scenemanager.loadScene and the name of the scene as parameter. A detail that I didn't mention before is that in order to execute this instruction, it's necessary to implement this namespace, UnityEngine.SceneManagement. If you don't implement that, it will give you an error. Then this function can be called in two ways. One is by pressing the escape key, and the other is by pressing the button. That's all I wanted to show you. I hope you found it useful. Don't forget to subscribe, and see you in the next video. Bye.